What if I told you that I've invented a device that uses sulfuric acid to make an explosive gas and that gas ignites spontaneously? It sounds like I'm making a bomb. Like, don't back my Kickstarter on this one, it's a terrible idea. But when a German chemist started making this device in 1823, thousands of people bought it and put it in their homes. 3 years later, it was obsolete. This is the story of Dobrynia's lamp. Yeah, so basically, by some definition, Dobrynia's lamp was the first ever lighter, and it uses an almost magical process that I had no idea existed. It's actually a process we use all the time in the modern world, as I have now discovered, but the very first device to use it was this one, a jar of sulfuric acid that posh Germans used to set things on fire. The way it works is, this is the magic, when you blow hydrogen over the surface of a metal, the hydrogen spontaneously burns. It can't be any metal, it needs to be platinum. But isn't that weird? Like, you don't need heat to get it started, you don't need a spark, it just happens. And because it's an exothermic reaction, it just gets hotter and hotter until the platinum is glowing and you can use it to light your oil lamp or whatever. Now, some of you might already know what I'm talking about, but for those who don't, it's called platinum catalysis. And yes, I should have known about platinum catalysis by now, but we all reach adulthood with strange gaps in our knowledge. Maybe yours is that you thought there was an X in espresso. What a moron. Mine is that I didn't know platinum catalysis was a thing. Also, I thought the saying was doggy dog world. That's my other one. Needless to say, I became obsessed with owning one of these things. Like, you can buy an original antique, but it'll cost you thousands, and you can't even set it on fire. And of course, I wanted one that I could set on fire. That's when I got in touch with Marcus from Marb's Lab YouTube channel to see if he could help. And brilliantly, he said, "I'll make one for you." How cool is that? I now have my very own working Dobrynia's lamp thanks to Marcus. Check out his brilliant making of video, link to that in the description. So how does this thing work? Well, platinum isn't the only metal involved. The other one is zinc. When you put zinc in sulfuric acid, something really interesting happens. Look at those bubbles forming. That's because sulfuric acid, any acid, has lots of positively charged hydrogen ions floating around. And because they're positively charged, it means they're going to grab onto any electrons that they can find. Now, zinc only holds its two outer electrons very weakly. So if you wait around long enough, two hydrogen ions will come along and steal those electrons, which means you've now got hydrogen atoms, and they're really unstable because they have incomplete outer shells. And so when they bump into each other, they form hydrogen molecules. Hydrogen is a gas at room temperature and pressure, and so that's why you have these bubbles. They're bubbles of hydrogen. The thing is, though, you don't want to have to be manually dipping your zinc into your sulfuric acid every time you want a little bit of hydrogen. Instead, you want an automated system where you always have a little reserve of hydrogen gas. And that's what this little upside down glass cone is for. As more and more hydrogen is produced, this cone fills up with gas, and that pushes the sulfuric acid down. Eventually, so much hydrogen gas has been produced that all of the sulfuric acid has been expelled from the cone. That removes the zinc from the acid, and so the hydrogen production stops. But look, there's a tube coming off of this cone, which leads up to here, where there's this valve. Right now, the valve is closed so that none of the hydrogen can escape. But if I open it just a little bit, a thin jet of hydrogen gas will shoot out of this tiny hole. With the hydrogen gas leaving the cone, the level of sulfuric acid in there will rise, and once again it will touch the zinc. That restarts the chemical reaction, replenishing the lost hydrogen. Now, in the original Dobrynia's lamp, what you would have here is something called a platinum sponge. But that seems like something you just can't buy these days. What you can get instead is platinum-coated wool, or this stuff, which is called platinum bright embers. But it's the same deal. You've got a kind of ceramic wool coated in platinum. So what happens when the hydrogen gas blows over the platinum? Well, what we want is for the hydrogen to react with the oxygen in the air. We want it to burn. By the way, burn is the right word here, but it seems a little odd. Because normally when you burn something, you're left with carbon dioxide and maybe some soot and ash. But when you burn hydrogen, which is to say when you react it with oxygen, the only product of that reaction is water. Now, you probably know that hydrogen and oxygen aren't going to react on their own. That's because the hydrogens are already paired with each other and the oxygens are already paired with each other, and you'd have to tear them apart before you can stick them back together as H2O. You can do that tearing apart with heat. For example, this balloon has a perfect mixture of hydrogen and oxygen, and you only need to make one small part of it very hot for the whole thing to get very hot very quickly. But that's not what we're doing here. Instead, what happens is the oxygen and hydrogen molecules are very gently attracted to this platinum surface by those weak van der Waals forces. But really, they're being lured in because the platinum has this sea of free electrons that you find in metals. To figure out why that's important, I needed to learn something new about orbitals. Like, I understood orbitals around atoms. You know, you've got the spherical ones, the dumbbell-shaped ones, and they've got different names, the S, P, D, and so on. But when you've got a covalent bond where two atoms are sharing electrons, well, that's a completely different type of orbital. And just like with normal orbitals, these covalent bond orbitals have different energy levels, and the lowest energy levels are filled first. And it's those lowest energy bond orbitals that hold the molecule together. In this diagram, white represents where we're likely to find the electron. But here's the thing, the next energy level up is peculiar. Now, we don't really need to get into the quantum mechanics of all of this, thankfully, but it's worth just remembering that electrons behave like waves. And it just so happens that in the next bond orbital up, those waves cancel out in the region between the two atoms of hydrogen. And instead, you find them on the outside. In this diagram, white and black represent where we're likely to find the electron, and gray where we're unlikely to find the electron. They're shown as opposite colors because they're out of phase. And so now these exposed positively charged nuclei are repelling each other, and they're attracted to those negatively charged electrons on the outside. And so this type of orbital is given the name antibonding orbital because when electrons get in there, they tend to pull the molecule apart. And so when that hydrogen molecule gets close enough to the surface of the platinum because it's attracted by weak van der Waals forces, some of those electrons from the platinum flow into the antibonding orbital of the hydrogen until the hydrogen molecule is pulled apart and you end up with just two hydrogens on the surface of the platinum. A similar thing happens to the oxygen molecule, and so you end up with a platinum surface that's just full of all of these hydrogen and oxygen molecules floating around on their own. And of course they're highly reactive because they have those incomplete outer shells, and so when they bump into each other, they bond, and you end up with water molecules forming. And that's almost the end of the story, except, you know, this is a catalyst. So once the water molecule is formed, it needs to get out of there, otherwise it's going to gum everything up. And that's mostly achieved by the fact that water just doesn't bond as well to platinum. But there's something else. Think about what happens when the hydrogen and oxygen atoms come together. Well, they're attracted to each other, like these magnets are attracted to each other. And so they're going to gain kinetic energy as they race towards each other. But what's going to happen to all that kinetic energy when they collide? Well, just like with these magnets, that kinetic energy turns into wobble. In other words, the water molecule has additional wobble that the hydrogens and oxygens didn't have on their own. And that additional wobble also helps the water molecule to leave the platinum surface. But of course, molecular wobble is just heat, so it also gets very, very hot. Some of the heat transfers to the platinum until it's glowing, at which point you can light your candle. My channel just turned 16, by the way. Happy birthday. Could we not have got a nicer cake, by the way?
No.
At this point, you might be thinking that's pretty cool, but it's not desperately practical. Like, if that spills in my rucksack, it's going to burn a hole in the bottom of my rucksack. So why were 17th century Germans so hyped about it? I suppose the answer is about perspective. Like, we take fire for granted because we can make it so easily. We don't often take the time to reflect on the fact that it keeps us warm and it unlocks nutrients in the food that we cook. But in 1823, people thought about fire a lot because it was hard to make. Options you had at the time were flint and steel, fire piston, or maybe rubbing sticks together. Basically, everyone was on the lookout for an easy way to make fire. Which also explains why Dobrynia's lamp was so short-lived, because in 1827, British chemist John Walker invented the strike anywhere match, or as they called it at the time, the match. So everyone started using matches instead of Dobrynia's lamp. But then safer, more portable lighter designs came along and they mostly replaced the match, and that's where we are today. I think it's unlikely that we'll see any significant developments in lighter technology from now on because, well, look, we've reached the pinnacle. I mentioned earlier that platinum catalysts are used all the time these days. Here's a couple of examples that I really like. This is a Zippo hand warmer. You fill it with lighter fluid just like you would with a normal Zippo, but then you just sort of hold a flame over this surface for a few seconds, after which it seems like nothing has happened. But it just kind of gets really warm and then stays really warm for about 6 hours. That's because lighter fluid is somewhat volatile, so it's evaporating all the time and it's passing over this catalytic wall, which again is just a ceramic wall with a platinum coating, which really is the only easy way to get hold of platinum these days, either that or this platinum bright embers stuff. But anyway, that's what we're using in the Dobrynia's lamp. You might be wondering why it needs to be wool or a sponge instead of just a block or a plate of platinum. And of course, the answer is surface area. Because the reaction happens on the surface of the metal, because the oxygen and hydrogen are adsorbed onto the surface, if you want more reaction, you need more surface. This is a catalytic perfume diffuser. You light it and leave it lit for a few seconds and then blow it out. And just like with the Zippo hand warmer, it stays hot. The large surface area of platinum is less obvious with this thing. But if you look up close, you can see that ceramic surface is really rough. And of course, that rough surface is coated in platinum. In this case, it's the alcoholic solvent that adsorbs onto the platinum and reacts with oxygen. But again, it's this weird kind of controlled burning. It's hot, but it's not too hot. There's no flame, but it's self-sustained. The coolest example, though, in my opinion, is this thing, a hydrogen fuel cell. Here, the oxygen and hydrogen flow over two separate platinum surfaces with a membrane in between. Hydrogen atoms can't get through the membrane, but hydrogen ions can. So when the platinum surface pulls the electrons away from the hydrogen, those newly formed ions can pass through the membrane. The stripped away electrons, on the other hand, can't. They have to take this circuitous route all the way around to the other platinum surface, where they're donated to the oxygens, allowing the hydrogen and the oxygen to snap together to form water. And of course, that circuitous route is a circuit that powers some electronics, like this little fan. The cool thing about this one is it's reversible. So if I push electricity through it in the opposite direction, then it splits water into hydrogen and oxygen. And look, you can see those two tanks there filling with hydrogen and oxygen gas. These two tanks of hydrogen and oxygen can then be used to power the hydrogen fuel cell and drive your motor or whatever you want to do. So yeah, this little device was dangerous, overcomplicated, and weirdly beautiful. But it was also a glimpse into a future where controlled chemistry, portable heat, and instant fire were available to everyone. What if I told you the sponsor of this video doesn't want your money, and actually they want to give you something? It sounds like there's got to be a catch. Let me explain. Jane Street is a quantitative trading firm that uses machine learning and statistics to trade on markets around the world. And it's powered by inquisitive people like you. That's why they want to meet you at one of their programs. They have loads of different programs throughout the year, but the one they're promoting right now is a two-day program called WISE at their Hong Kong, New York, and London offices. The program is open to women and gender-expansive people who are about to start university, and you'll get to find out what a career at Jane Street looks like. You don't need any experience in finance, just an interest in STEM, which I know you have, and you don't even need to live in or near those cities. They'll even cover your travel and accommodation. Applications are open now, but they close May 18th for the Hong Kong program and June 15th for the others. The link is in the description, so why not apply today? I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe. And the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.